Let's begin. This is going to be a fun. I had no idea we'd start at 6:16, so we're going to, I'll try and not wear you out tonight. But here are our five questions. What sins would, I thought this would be a record. We'll just answer all of them rapidly. What sins would keep someone from going to heaven? Any sin can keep someone from going to heaven. Any sin, because God doesn't allow any into heaven. And he doesn't allow anybody who dies in their sin, with their sin on them, to go to heaven. So any sin can keep anyone from heaven. If you die with a sin on you, in your sin, as Jesus called it, you can't go to heaven. Second question. Wasn't that a quick answer? Is any sin greater than another, as in sexual sins? And I'm not sure if they're talking about homosexuality, lesbianism, deviance, or whatever. Yes, some sins are greater than other sins, and the Bible says so. Thirdly, can a believer lose their salvation? No. Why? Because no one or nothing can undo something God has done. See, loss of salvation is impinging upon one of the attributes of God, that God is all-powerful. And he said our salvation, in fact, I'll show you this in a minute, in Jude, the last two verses, says, now unto him that is able has all power to keep us from falling, falling away, falling out, falling into destruction. So can a believer lose their salvation? No, because you can't undo something God has done. Next one, can a true believer live in sin to the very end of their life and still go to heaven? No. No. That it's very clearly laid out in the Bible. Why? Because God stops true believers from living a life of sin because he's put his name on them. And he says, you're not going to be acting, when you're born into my family, you cannot act any longer like you're of your father, the devil. And if you want to and choose to, I'm going to interfere with your life to whatever level I have to interfere to make you stop. So the quick answer, these are all the quick answers. I just wanted to give you the quick answers. No, a true believer cannot live in sin to the very end of their life and still go to heaven, because if they live in sin to the very end of their life and God doesn't intervene, they weren't a true believer. Finally, did you use the terms for pastors and elders synonymously last Sunday night? Yes. And I'll show you that God does twice. And I think that that's a little piece of the puzzle that a lot of people have never figured out, that elders, well, there's several, someone asked me about this in the lobby, and I'll tell you what I told them because I didn't add it in tonight. They said, we're from a Baptist background. I said, well, I'm an ordained Baptist minister. Yes. That's, yay, it's good to meet you. And they said, well, we didn't have elders in our church. I said, oh yeah, you did, you had one. The pastor, because the term pastor, bishop, overseer, elder, all of those terms are used interchangeably and synonymously. Now they all talk about a different function that the person, the overseer, oversees. The elder, it speaks of the aged, like in Hebrew, the word elder is zakein, means white hair. It means that they're a wise, seasoned, you know, godly type of person. Pastor speaks of shepherding. And so an elder is to shepherd, an elder is to be wise, godly, and an elder is to oversee. And so they're interchangeable terms. But the problem is that there's never an example in the New Testament of a local church that only had one. See, that's the one thing that if I could be so bold as to say the Baptists do anything wrong, is they don't realize that there's always a plurality of elders in every local New Testament church. It was never a solo. And there's a great benefit, as Calvary experiences with the 14 elders here. The plurality of elders, some labor in the doctrine and teaching, and others are primarily laboring and overseeing, but there's always a plurality. But let's go to the long form of all these. And I want you to get your Bible, because I want you to see this, because instead of me injecting in, you know, oh, I think this, or my opinion, or it'd be wise to say that. What sins would keep someone from going to heaven? Well, the short answer, any sin that any person dies with that sin, still clinging to their accounts, keeps them from going to heaven. Look at the Gospel by John for a moment. We were a couple weeks ago, we were actually going through this, all these little verses. But look at 8:24. This is probably of the two worst things Jesus ever said. I'm not sure which statement Jesus made is worse. One statement we're going to see later on tonight is, I never knew you. Those, I would say, are the four worst words anybody could ever hear. In fact, what's going to be horrible is a lot of churchgoers are going to hear those four words. And they are the most horrible, damnable words in the universe. Because following that, Jesus said, you have to go into the lake of fire I prepared for the devil and his angels, and you are in my church. But I never knew you. But close on that is 8:24 of John's Gospel. So I would say tied with those awful words are these. Therefore I say to you that you will, and look at this, die in your sins. You see, John 8:24 says that anybody that dies with their sins still clinging to them, John 8:24, it's just as bad as Jesus saying, I never knew you. Because God's wrath is eternally revealed against sin. Romans 1 says, God's wrath is forever going to be poured out against sin. And so any sins that do not come under the atoning work of Christ on the cross, that Jesus takes that sinner's place and takes that sinner's sin upon himself, and God treats Jesus like he committed that person's sins, all of them, that person will die holding on to their sin. And that will keep them from going to heaven because they can't get to heaven until the penalty for that sin is paid, even if it's one. And the wages of sin is death, eternal. They would need to forever pay for one sin. By the way, James 2:10, you all know that one. It says, for whoever keeps the whole law and yet offends in one point, the same is guilty what? So if you commit one sin, it's like you committed them all. See, a lot of people say, well, they're not as bad as... We love the comparative degree, don't we? We always say, I'm not as bad as they are. You know, they're worse than we are. You know, their kids are worse than our kids. And, you know, whatever, their marriage is, you know, we love the comparative degree. God says, if I commit even one sin, I'm guilty of all. So how many sins can keep someone from going to heaven? One. Now, here's the theology, though. Look at Hebrews chapter 10. And I just love these questions because on Sunday afternoon, I actually sit with a piece of paper. Usually I pull it out of the trash. And I jot off, you know, it's the back side because you got to use both sides of that paper. I jot off every verse I can think of for those questions. And immediately, I mean, with this one, I thought of John 8:24, James 2:10. But this is the key. And I want you to look at what it says in Hebrews 10. And this is the foundation of the atoning sacrifice, the justifying death of Christ. And look what it says. In fact, in my Bible, I have a little daisy chain where I circle this reference to the fact that Jesus died once for all time, once. It says in verse 10 of Hebrews 10 that by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ. And what does it say? Once for all. How many times has Jesus been crucified? Once. How many times will he be crucified? Once. When someone sins tomorrow, does Jesus need to go back to the cross? No. By one sacrifice, once and for all, Jesus paid the price that is sufficient. Now, remember, one of the, now these two words are not in the Bible. In this term, but this is how we understand, how we finally piece this together. The death, this once and for all death on the cross was sufficient for the whole world. And no matter what your theological persuasion is, it actually says that in the Bible. So it doesn't matter whether you're Arminian or Calvinist. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also for the sin, 1 John 2:1. of the whole world. So what Jesus did on the cross was sufficient for the whole world, but it will not be taken. So it's only efficient. That means it only affects, it only, because did you know what one of the dangers, if you study church history, do you know what one of the offshoots of Calvin's Geneva was? A group moved from Geneva where Calvin ministered and taught through the Bible and wrote the institutes and everything. And they moved to Prague and they started the Church of Universalism. That's an offshoot of Calvinism. Do you know why? If an omnipotent God has all power, offered himself as God on the cross, then the sacrifice was an omnipotent sacrifice that has to save all. That's what universalism is based. Now, I don't mean the Unitarian Universal Church, the local one, but originally in church history, the universal ideas, universalism ideas that everyone's going to ultimately be saved, were based on the fact of a misunderstanding of the sufficiency and confusing it with the efficiency. That Jesus died a death that was sufficient in his one sacrifice for all time. It was able to cover the sin. In fact, John, the last prophet of the Old Testament, John the Baptist, said, and he pointed, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away," and he says, "the sin." Doesn't say sins, the sin. Jesus made a sufficient sacrifice for the sin of the world, but it's only efficient for the sins of those who come in response to Christ's call for the elect. And so you just have to put that together in your mind. But Jesus only died for sins once. And look what it keeps saying in verse 11. Every priest standing ministering, I'm in Hebrews 10, 11, daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices can never take away sins. But this man, verse 12, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down. You know, it's real interesting. The book of Hebrews is so interesting because it interprets the tabernacle and the temple. The tabernacle and the temple had no chairs in them because their work was never done. They were going, if you've ever read about the Day of Atonement, they had about 72 steps, and they were just going back and forth and killing this animal and skinning it and then moving the blood and sprinkling it here and then burning a little bit here and then going over and putting some incense over it, and they just were really busy. And they never, as soon as they got done with that, they had to start up again. Look what it says. Repeatedly, verse 11, the same sacrifices can never take care of sins. But this man, after he'd offered, and there's that one again, if you get to verse 10 and then verse 12, one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down. The work was done. Never has to be repeated. And then it says, from that time, verse 13, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool, verse 14, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are. Now look at, this is what's so interesting. It says in that 14th verse, those who are being sanctified. Did you know that the only people that go to heaven are those that are being sanctified? Now you might have heard of a controversy that kind of went full-blown in the 80s. It's kind of died down, not because it's not a controversy, but because people don't really get into doctrine very much these days. Major churches don't. But the whole contention of what you may have heard of called the lordship, if you've ever heard of the lordship controversy, that big word lordship, right here is the crux of it. The lordship proponents, which are almost all Reformed theologians that are into doctrine, would be lordship proponents. Why? Because the Bible teaches that everyone that the sacrifice of Christ justified, justification is Christ's death in my place as my substitute, being punished like he committed my sins. Everyone that has been justified, it says in Romans 8, for whom he justified those he's going to sanctify. And so the crux of the lordship controversy is what it says in verse 14. By one offering, he has perfected forever those who are at this present moment. If they're saved, they're being sanctified. So we'll get to that at a later point. But either Jesus has, and let me get rid of all this writing. Oh, this isn't the one I tap. I have to go like this, but I just want you to see this. Get rid of all this stuff so you can read it there. Jesus only died for sin once, and he saves us and justifies us either from all sins or no sins. There's no partial salvations possible. And see, the people that teach this partial, in fact, Roman Catholicism, this is the heart of what's wrong with, if you've ever heard of Roman Catholic theology having errors, it's right here. Roman Catholic theology is predicated on the fact that all of your sins aren't taken care of. You got to go and get some of them taken care of in purgatory. And that the Mass involves Jesus being sacrificed over and over again when he offered one sacrifice forever. So this is the heart of the error. It's an error in understanding justification, because justification says, by one sacrifice, Jesus justified us from all sins. So, whoa, that was a little long, so we better move on to the next one. Is any sin greater than any other, as in sexual sins? Well, let's turn to 1 John 3:4. The question is, are there big and little sins, mortal and venial? I mean, that's Catholic theology, but are there big sins and little sins? Are any sins greater than others? Well, yes, yes. But first, let's talk about sin. Let's do a harmartiology, a study of sin. All sin, look at 1 John 3:4. First thing about all sin is, whosoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. And sin is lawlessness. So in one sense, all sin is equally categorized by God as lawlessness. But there are sins. Now keep going in 1 John to chapter 5. Now let's talk about degrees or gradients of sin. There are sins that lead to death, and there are sins that don't lead to death. Now, don't get confused here. It says in Romans 3:23 that the wages of any sin is death, right? Any sin leads to death. I'm not talking about natural physical death that every human that's ever sinned is going to go through, except for those who Jesus comes to take, but 99% of all believers of all time are going to go through the valley of the shadow of death with Christ leading them. But what is 1 John 5? Look at verses 16 and 17. If anyone sees a brother sinning a sin which does not lead to death, you know, when you're reading through the Bible in 1 year and you get to that verse, you pause for a moment and go, I wonder what that means. But we keep reading because we're Americans and we like progress and we're going to check it off that we read it. So we keep reading and we say, he will ask, and he will give him life for those who commit sin not leading to death. And we pause again. We go, what did I just read? But we persist reading. There is sin leading to death. I do not say that he should pray about that. We say, I'm going to ask about that in Sunday school. You know, what is that? But we just keep going. But then it says, verse 17, all unrighteousness is sin, and there is sin not leading to death. Now basically, and we're gonna get into all the passages that talk about this a couple questions from now, but God says there's two kinds of sins. There is normal sin, and then there are sins that if believers commit them and don't repent of them, they're going to lead to what we would call an untimely death. Now I'll give you an anecdotal story. This is not in the Bible, but I did see it happen. My youth group president in East Lansing, Michigan, when I was a freshman in high school, was the coolest guy in East Lansing. He had the best motorcycle, beautiful blonde hair, and he loved it too. He was always working on it. one of those weightlifter types that was built like a V. He had one problem. He was a remarkable leader of our youth group. I mean, when he came, everybody came. He'd lead the music, he could teach. Every retreat that he went on, we all went on. I mean, he was just a magnet. But he was also a magnet for the girls. And he kind of had this other life where he was always messing around all through high school, back when it wasn't normal. Now it's kind of everybody messes around. But it was back then when it was more like just Elvis Presley, you know, or, you know, the Beatles messed around, but not everybody. He was, in his senior year, our youth group guy, and he had his motorcycle, and he was showing off, and you know, how they can drive on one wheel and all that stuff and go really fast and balance and everything, and he wanted to make sure everybody was watching, and so he is really going way too fast for motorcycle. And he got it up on one wheel and he looked back at all of us. And what he didn't see was that he was going way too fast and he'd gotten over and there was a semi parked there and he actually went underneath the semi. Well, at least the motorcycle and most of his body did, but a lot of it didn't. And it just decapitated and dismembered him. And you know, after that, none of us knew about his other life. Well, all the girls he was with knew about it, of course. But as their parents found out, it came out that it was what our pastor, I'll never forget the sobering message he gave about really believing that this guy was involved in a sin that led to death. Because he was really a believer, but he was false and hypocritical and living in fornication and still doing the holy ministry of the word. But whether you like that anecdotal and whether someday, you know, the Lord will explain that to us. We do know this. For believers, there are some sins. Look back at what the text says. If you see your brother, that's a born-again person, verse 16, sinning a sin that does not lead to death, he will ask and will give him life for those who commit sin not leading to death. In other words, if that person is involved in a sin and they're asking for help and they say, I struggle with this and I struggle with this. And in fact, someone asked me this morning, they said, give me an example of that. I said, I'll give you an example of that. I used to pastor in Rhode Island 30 years ago, and we were right next to the largest gay community. I mean, they're not gay. They're very unhappy. But we were next to the largest supposedly gay community. And those people were always bricking each other. That's where you hit someone and break their facial bones with a brick if they're unfaithful, you know, with some other man, and you're supposed to be with them and all that stuff. It's really messy and awful. But did you know that after they got saved, they did not instantly like girls? In fact, most of them, for the whole time that I knew and discipled them, they had to avoid gyms. Because if some guy ripped his shirt off, their heart would start pounding and they'd be drawn to him. They couldn't take their eyes off of him. Their temptation was completely different than ours, but it was as real as any man, you know, walking down the beach at the height of summer would have to avert his eyes. They had to avert their eyes from the weightlifter guys, and etc. And so there are sins. I mean, for them to say, I'm struggling with that is one thing, but for them to give into it and persist, let's say one of them, in the going back into the homosexual world, where one of them that I led to the Lord and baptized and discipled had 600 different male partners. To go back into that world, if he didn't repent, if he was truly born again, the Bible says in 1 John 5, 16 and 17, it would lead to his death. He would have, the Bible says, an untimely death. Okay, so there are different levels of sin, but now look at Matthew 12. Let's look at this, because there's some really even worse sins than homosexuality and lesbianism and gluttony and covetousness, which are all huge bad sins. Look at Matthew 12, because there are some sins that are unforgivable. And it says in Matthew 12, verses 31 and 32, that there are these things called sins against the Spirit. Now listen to how sobering this is. In 12:31, therefore I say unto you that every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men. Wow. That means every type of deviance, you can just, any deviant you can think of, in any gross immoral sin that's right now in life imprisonment, Jesus says in verse 31, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men. There is no sin that is unforgivable except one. Here it is. But the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven men. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man, it will be forgiven him. But whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit, now listen, this is heavy. It will not be forgiven him either in this age or in the age to come. There aren't very many things Jesus ever said anything like that about. So there are sins that are unforgivable. Now nobody asked me, you know, what that is, so we won't cover them tonight. But basically, I would give you a quick short one. I believe blasphemy against the Holy Spirit was only possible when Christ was on earth. And what happened is Jesus Christ was raising people from the dead. The religious leaders were saying, that's the devil doing that. It's not God. And when Jesus would heal a leper, they'd say, that's a demon doing that. That's not God. And when Jesus would perform all of his, we talked about tonight, those sign miracles, the people that hated him, the religious leaders, would say, that's not God. And they were sinning against the Holy Spirit, who was energizing all of those miracles through Christ. So is it possible, theologically, today, to commit the unpardonable sin? Only this unpardonable sin. There is one other unpardonable sin, and that's the sin of neglecting Christ. In other words, hearing the gospel, saying no, and dying that way. That sin will never be forgiven because you didn't embrace the Savior. But that's a passive sin. But an active sin of blaspheming the Holy Spirit, the climate for that is no longer possible. Now, here's one last thing, and I think this probably is what the person was asking about. But look at 1 Corinthians 6:18. I believe this person heard somewhere that you really need to be careful about moral things because those are really bad sins. Well, the Bible does say this. It's very interesting. The context is, if you look at 1 Corinthians 6 and back up a little bit, he starts in verse 15. Kind of the running into this. He says, do you not know your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? But well, what is a harlot in the biblical terminology? It is having sexual relations with someone you're not married to, and you move between them. You know what that is? That's college life today. It's harlotress. And all those people that pose, you know, for all the pictures are harlots too. You know what the Lord says? Don't you know your body is a member of Christ? Should you be involved in harlotrous behavior? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, shall become one. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. And what Paul is saying in this terminology is, why on earth, you who are joined to Christ, would you join Christ to a harlotrous immoral. I mean, Jesus is in you as you're doing that. And he says, you shouldn't do that. Now look what he says in verse 18. Flee sexual immorality. And this, I think, is what the person was asking about. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. What does that mean? Well, keep reading. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? So what Paul is saying is, you can overweight your body, you can over-anxiety your body, you can under-exercise your body, you can, you know, smoke and cancerate your body and lay under those sun lamps and get skin cancer all you want. And that's one thing, but you take your body, and you can use your body to hurt people, and you can use your body to say mean things to people. But if you join the holy temple of God into an immoral union, you are sinning in a special way because verse 19, your body is the very temple of the Holy Spirit. So, in that sense, are any sins greater than others? at the basic level, all sins are lawlessness. But there are some sins, if you don't repent of, the Lord will, and we'll see this in a little while, kill you. You can sin an unpardonable sin, but Paul said, watch out. There's something different about sexual sins. There's something different that the writer of Proverbs says. It's like taking hot coals and dumping them down your shirt. That doesn't sound very good to me. Hot, you know, next time you're grilling your hamburgers, think of getting a big scooper of those red hot embers and dumping them down your shirt and thinking of all the corollary damage that will come of that. You ruin your clothes, ruin your skin. You know, who knows all that can happen. And the Lord says, you should be careful because your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. So that's the second one. We're not doing very well on time here, but I'm glad we answered them all already. Can a believer lose their salvation? No. And let's just look real quickly. And these, by the way, what I'm doing with you is what we do every Wednesday night. This is exactly what our biblical discipleship and counseling class is like. Because biblical counseling is just like a Q&A, only you have to listen to the person's struggle to find the question they're asking. A lot of people don't know how to frame the question they're asking. And so if you listen long enough, you can frame it. But this one is huge in the church. This one is one of the most common. When people come in for questions, you know, usually they have their question and they have the real reason they came in for a counseling appointment. And many people struggle with wondering if they're saved or if they were saved or if they can ever be saved or if they lost their salvation or if they committed a sin that is too bad and the Lord's going to whomp them, you know, for that. So let's look at John 10:28. This is for anybody that struggles with assurance. The whole 10th chapter. And Lord willing, we should get there next week, Sunday morning, Lord willing. But look at verses 28 and 29, and now you don't have to come next Sunday morning if you really get this, okay? I'm teasing. It says, I'll start in 27, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. There's one of the clearest descriptions of what salvation is. Salvation is the instant we become Christ's sheep. We are born into his family. We can hear his voice. And when we hear his voice, we respond and follow him. You know, the Bible says the bottom line of assurance is the Lord knows those that are his. And so it doesn't matter what anybody tells you. It doesn't matter what anybody says, don't worry about that. I know you're a Christian. Don't worry about that. Worry about that. Until you know that you are his sheep, you've heard his voice, and you're following him. But can you lose that once that happens? See, we're starting on 28 because I'm not talking about the act of salvation. I'm talking about the security of salvation. And the security of salvation is, can we undo what only God has done or can do? And what it says in verse 28 is, I give them eternal life. That's a sovereign act of God. People cannot, there's a terrible movement in Christendom, and it's this command God movement, command God to do stuff, that we can hold God hostage and make him do stuff if we say the right form of words. It's part of the faith, you know, word of faith movement and all that, you know, name it and claim it stuff, and God has to do this, you know, and they're holding him on that. Well, you know what? I give them eternal life. And God is the one, salvation is of the Lord, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. Anyone. Now, many times I've had anxious people sitting, you know, in a chair or on the couch, and they're not sure they're saved. And they say, okay, I understand that anyone means that no one, like some terrorist or some enemy of mine or some demonized person, no one can take my salvation away. But what if I did something to undo it? And I said, you're not anyone? You mean you are not anyone? Are you telling me you're someone, right? You're better than anyone. I'm teasing with him. What I'm saying is, this means anyone, including yourself. What this is saying is, that you can't even unsave yourself. anyone. Neither can anyone. Look back at what it says. Shall anyone snatch them out of my Father's hand. The Lord pictures salvation as that we're in God's hand, kind of in this protected area, here we are, and that Christ, it says we are in God's hands with Christ in God. It's like we have the Spirit's within us, we're in Christ, and we're in God's hands. We have this triply secure sealing, and the Lord says, you're secure because anyone, including you, can't get you out of there. You can't unsave yourself because you didn't save yourself. See, the problem is with losing salvation, the people that lose their salvation are the ones that thought they gained it for themselves. And by the way, another thing that I always share with people is, if you lose something, that means at one time you had it, right? You lose your car keys, it doesn't mean you never had them. It means at one point you were possessing them, and now you're not. And so people that feel they have lost their salvation are actually telling me at one time, what? They had it. And all you have to do is share with them the security that no one, not even you, can snatch them out of my Father's hand. And look what verse 29 says, my Father who has given them to me, see, this is Jesus describing this, you know, the Father and the Son and the Spirit who lives within. He says, the Father who gave them to me is greater than all. And no one, see, anyone and no one, not even you, and no one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. So can a believer lose their salvation? No. The Bible says, and by the way, Jude 24 and 25 is a great, it's one of the great doxologies, and those are great to memorize because they're so full of truth. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God be glory and majesty, dominion, and power both now and forever. Jude 24 and 25 reiterates what Jesus said in John 10, that God is able to keep us from falling. And I always tell the story, when my kids were little, they used to ride on my shoulders. And when they didn't understand the ropes, they used to cling. They pulled my hair and they just cling. But finally, when they realized them being on my shoulders was not how hard they were holding on, I had them in a lock. I mean, I had their little feet, and I was ready at any quiver. I had them, and I would fall before they would. And God says, I'll fall before you do, because I am holding you. It doesn't matter how hard you're holding on to me. So just a beautiful reminder of salvation security. But let's get to number 4 and hope we can get to number 5. Now you notice this is several parts, 4A and B and C, because it's so big. Because what we really need to talk about, really, is this. Can a true believer, live in sin to the very end of their life? First, let's look at who God says doesn't go to heaven. This is what prompted this. This actually started, the switchboards lit up after the first message on salvation. Let's go to Revelation 21:8. This was, we're right in the middle of the Throne Room of the Universe series, and I just had everybody flip to the end, and I says, well, let's just look at everybody that's going to be in heaven. And I very lightly read this list. And look at Revelation 21:8. And by the way, all these verses that I'm telling you about, if you're ever going to talk to people, minister to people, do personal work, do any biblical counseling or discipleship, these are some of the key verses in the whole Bible that you should have somehow noted and starred or something. But this is what it says. And 21 is the new heaven, new earth, and we're in the eternal state. And he starts in verse 7, he who overcomes, and don't define overcoming by what you think it means. That is a biblically defined term. And it says in 1 John that an overcomer is equal to a born-again believer. There is not There aren't super Christians and normal ones and then bad ones. All Christians, the Bible says, anybody that's saved, anybody that's going to heaven is an overcomer. They have overcome sin and death and hell and destruction and the grave and the power of sin. It's part of salvation. It's kind of like trying to pull out, you know, some part of your, strip out some of your DNA out of every cell. You can't do that. It's part of the DNA of a believer that they're an overcomer. But he who overcomes, that's a born-again Christian, you don't have to define it in Revelation 21:8. It's been defined all the way through 1 John and the beginning of Revelation. So there's no new meaning here. He who overcomes shall inherit all things. So believers inherit all things. And I will be his God. Believers find the fulfillment of, the Lord says, Emmanuel, God with us, and you will dwell in my house. I mean, this is just reiterating everything that believers have already been told. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But as many as receive him, to them he gave the right to become the sons of God. So see, this is just all what we already know. But, now look at verse 8. Look at this list of who doesn't go to heaven. Is that on your radar? Cowardly? Cowardly? First? These are the fearful people that are in Romans 1. God says, I haven't given you a spirit of fear. We need to work on that. Because a lot of people live in dread fear. And God doesn't like fear. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the abominable, murderers, sexually immoral. Now, I mentioned this morning, did you know there's a danger? For decades, youth speakers have told young people, you're going to struggle in college. Everybody does. When you get to be about 30, you'll come back to the Lord and make him Lord of your life. Did you know those words, make him Lord, are not in the Bible. You cannot make Jesus Lord of your life. He already is if you're a Christian. And if he's not the Lord of your life, you're not a Christian. The Bible, like overcomer, he's already defined that in the Bible. But it says the sexually immoral, the sorcerers. That's an interesting word, pharmakeia. Has to do with drugs. Drugs are not new. They're very old. There has always been drug use tied with the occult and tied with opening the mind and being in this mentally affected, trance-like, hallucinatory type of behavior. In fact, if you ever heard of the Oracle of Delphi and all of those, they were involved in fact, there used to be a volcanic chasm that had vapors coming out of it, and they used to, in the Greek gods, they would put these priestesses over that vent and allow them to breathe in these poisonous gases, kind of like putting gas in your car and stand there, you know, and just sniffing that as long as you can until it starts affecting your mind, and then they would go into a trance and start giving prophecies. The Lord says, watch out for sorcery. Any drug-induced effects on your mind, and that opens your mind to the occult. Be careful of that. Idolaters, what is an idolater? Anybody that puts some created thing, an object or a desire, on the same shelf as God. That's idolatry, materialism, covetousness. And all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire, which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So I just read that, and the switchboard lit up, and people said, are you telling me that, you know, my friend is not going to heaven? I said, no, I didn't say that. Who wrote this? God said that. God says, those people, the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars will not be in heaven, but they are forever going to burn with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So who does God say won't go to heaven? That list. Now, real quickly, let's go to Ephesians 5, And I'm backing up through the Bible here. I'll just show you all the lists because, well, no, I won't show you all of them. It'd take too long. I'm going to show you a few of them because there are about 19 of these lists, sin lists, in the New Testament, and I'm only going to show you a handful. Therefore, be imitators of God, Ephesians 5:1, as dear children, and walk in love as Christ has loved us and gave himself as an offering, a sacrifice to God, a sweet smell. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you, as is fitting for saints, neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. And what I just said should absolutely change the lives of a lot of people if you really believe the Word of God. God says you shouldn't even have a hint of all that stuff. You're a saint. And don't say, I'm just joking, because God doesn't joke. And he doesn't like that kind of coarse, filthy, foolish talking, jesting. That's not fitting. If you don't know what to do, say you're thankful. Give thanks. You know, that's what he said. But now look, here's the punch. Ephesians 5:5. For this you know, that no fornicator, no one whose life is consistently and persistently characterized by fornication. And fornication is any sexual activity outside of marriage. Mental, physical, consensual, sporadic, just you can put any, you know, modifier on it. Fornication, any sexual activity outside of marriage. No fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Oh, inheritance. So do you know what? There's a movement now that says, oh, there are two, heaven has two sections. First class and coach. And in the coach are the fornicators. I mean, they just can't stop. And the covetous, they live their whole life for money, their job, their house, their clothes. You know what I mean? And the first class, those people that were so busy for God, you know, they're in the first class section. But we're in the coach. You say, that's not funny. It's not. But there's a whole group that believes that. And what they say that the inheritance is up here. These are the ones that inherit the kingdom of God. They are in first class. They're up there getting juice and steak, and we're getting peanuts and coach if you're on Southwest. I don't even know if they give food away in the other ones, but you know what I mean? The coach people are back there packed in like sardines, all those fornicators and covetous people and idolaters. And those people that were really into the Bible, they're up there in first class with the white tablecloth eating a steak. That's not what this is saying. Let no one deceive you, verse 6, with empty words, and that's very empty. With empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes on the sons of disobedience, therefore don't be partakers with them. Okay, let's look at another one. Look at Galatians 5, it says the same thing. Galatians 5, starting in verse 16. This I say, walk in the Spirit, and you'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh, for the flesh lusts against the Spirit, verse 17, the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary. And so that you don't do the things that you wish. For if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the tone changes. Now the works, verse 19, of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication. Isn't it interesting? Every one of these lists, fornication is either first or second. Always. Sexual sin. And we live in the most over-sexually stimulated culture in history. And it's getting worse. And so this is very relevant. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness. Adultery, married outside of marriage doing something. Fornication, involved in something without the covenant of marriage. Uncleanness is thinking and talking and loving and just being soaked in it. And there are those. I mean, they don't do it. They just love it, and they're around it, and they think about it, you know. Lewdness, idolatry. There's that pharmakia word again, sorcery, the whole occult thing. Hatred, contentions. Did you know a contentious person, someone that You say something, they say something else. They're always one-upping you, and they're never going to, they're very opinionated, and you're not going to let anybody. That is a sin. And it's a mark of the flesh, contentions, jealousies. Wow. Outbursts of wrath. Oh, I lost my temper. No, you didn't. You've never let go of it. You keep it. Selfish ambitions. That's the American dream. I'm going to get as much as I can. I'm going to climb over as many people as I have to. And if I can snooker you in a deal and make an extra $10,000, I'm going to laugh all the way to the bank because you're so dumb and you didn't know how much that was worth, and I did. And I'm going to make money. You know, I just bought something. I laughed about it. I told Bonnie about this. I paid with real money. And the poor lady at the counter, she counted it out, and she moved it all around. She couldn't count is the problem. And finally, she counted it so many times. She just put it all together, and she said an amount of money. And I looked at her in incredulity. I said, what'd you say? She said, isn't that how much you gave me? She was going to give me change back, a lot of change. I said, no. I gave you exactly the amount of the bill. And she couldn't believe that I wouldn't take. I mean, I would have made about $60 on the deal. And did you know the Lord says that is dishonest gain? People brag about how they got this, and the person didn't even know how much it was worth. Amazing. That's a part of our selfishly ambition, anything for myself, society. Dissensions, heresies. Those are people that elevate one thing above. You know, a heretic is someone that takes a point of doctrine and elevates it too high, kind of like those universalists did. Envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you before, as I've told you in time past, that those who practice, there's the key, practice such things, are going to be in coach. Oh, there comes that interpretation again. Because we don't want to tell people that grace the aisles of the church, that their persistence in sin is making them look like they're unsaved. And so we have to comfortably, it's almost like Roman Catholics made purgatory, evangelicals have made the coach section. And those, you know, goody two-shoes people, they're always reading their Bibles and memorizing and having their devotions and, you know, I mean, they're those kind, they just are all in God stuff all the time. But we're normal and we're revelrous and envious and jealous and fornicatious. But we're going to be in the coach section. God says, no, you're not even on the bus. You're not on the plane. Notice what it says. Shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It says in the Bible that when we're born again, we become co-heirs with Christ. That's what it means to be inheriting the kingdom of God. So the people in coach are not joined to Christ. And I could do the same thing for 1 Corinthians 6. You can read it yourself. Romans 1, you can read it for yourself. So can a true believer live in sin the very end of his life? First of all, who's a true believer? These people aren't. Second, in the church, and we'll probably only be able to do this, let's look at one of the most famous verses, 2 Corinthians 13:5. 2 Corinthians 13:5. You ever heard this verse? Examine yourself whether you're in the faith. Isn't that a beautiful verse? 2 Corinthians 13:5. This is an amazing verse. Why would Paul write that verse? Well, remember I told you this morning about how you don't understand John 9, 1 through 7, if you don't read John 8, 59. They were picking stones up to cast him at Jesus, and he slipped away. And as he's slipping away, he's cutting through the pools of Bethesda, and he sees a man that's been there that is blind. And Jesus stops, and they're chasing him with stones. And that was remarkable. Do you know what the context of this is? Look what this says in verse 5. Examine yourself as to whether you are in the faith, whether you're in the first class, the people going to heaven. You should check your ticket. You should see if you're saved. Don't let anybody tell you you are. You should examine yourself. In fact, that word examine is a very interesting word. It's kind of like, you ever watch a Western, you know, where they pay in gold and the guy takes the coin, he says, thanks, and he goes, what? What's he doing? It's that same word. He's examining the coin to see if it's soft as gold is, and if his teeth sink into the metal. Teeth don't sink into very many metals. And if you can bite that coin, you have a good idea that it's really gold. And what he says is, bite into your faith to see if you're really saved. And then he says, test yourselves. You know, remember the banks had to go through the stress test? Believers are supposed to go through this little test. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you are disqualified? It's very interesting. What's the context of that verse to examine yourself whether you're really saved? We'll back up to 2 Corinthians 12, verse 20. If we took out all these chapter divisions, people would understand a lot more about the Bible because we read segmentally, you know, unconnectedly. Look what it says in verse 20. For I fear, I mean, it's just an inch above. For I fear lest when I come I shall not find you as I wish, that you shall be found such as you do not wish, lest there be contentions and jealousies and outbursts of wrath and selfish ambitions and backbiting and whisperings and conceits and tumults, lest when I come my God will humble me among you, and I shall mourn for many who have sinned before and have not repented of the uncleanness and fornication and lewdness. The Corinthian church was doing all those things. You know what Paul said? Just because you're in this house church that I started, and by the way, there's not a house in Corinth. They've excavated the whole place. There's not a house in Corinth that could hold more than 100 people. So think, Paul spent 18 months pastoring a church that's the size of 90%+ of all churches in America. They're all, 90% of all churches are under 100, and that's the size church Paul pastored for 18 months. And those people in that church, with all the wickedness, I mean, if you ever go to the land of the book and go to Corinth, you see the gymnasium, which is central because they did the Pan-Ismenian Games in Corinth. So you're standing in the gymnasium, which means a place where you do sports with no clothes on. And as you're standing there, you're looking at the Acrocorinthus, which is the highest spot in the town. It's a mountaintop. And there was the temple to the goddess of lust. And between those two is where the leather makers were. There's Paul's, where Paul would disciple people. So he discipled people that walked by the naked gym place, looking up at the prostitute place. I mean, and then if you walk around the streets, I mean, whenever I take tours, you know, it's embarrassing what they carved in the streets. They carved what politely are called phallic symbols. And they had one for everything. You were into homosexuality, you'd follow that one. You're into heterosexuality, you'd follow that one. If you're into bestiality, lesbianism, you just followed the marks in the road. They're still there. They're carved in the pavement. And you know what Paul says? He says, you all need to examine yourself whether you're saved. Paul said that. He didn't say, I saw you raise your hand. Don't worry, you're in. You prayed? Good. No. He says, bite into it, see if it's real. Because it doesn't look like it's real. If you have outbursts of anger and jealousy and contentions, verse 20, and selfish ambitions and backbitings, and if you have uncleanness and fornication and lewdness in your life, examine yourself if you're in the faith. Now, real quickly, next time. This is fascinating. And this is why I don't want to rush through it. I think most people don't even know the biblical doctrine of chastening. You know what it says in Hebrews 12? Fascinating passage. If you have an old King James, there's a swear word in there. You know what it says? It says, if you say you're a Christian and you're living in sin, like in any of those lists, and nothing is happening, then God isn't your father. You are illegitimate. And it uses a swear word. You know what that means? God says that God will chasten everybody who is a believer. If they remain unchastened, they prove they are illegitimate and have never been born again children of God. That answers the question for people that say, well, I have this friend and we were in youth group together in middle school, and now, I mean, they've become a, you know, an agnostic, an atheist, and a lesbian, and they're a drug addict, and they're an alcoholic, and they deny God. What you ask is the Lord chastening them? If he never does, they're illegitimate. And we'll study the doctrine of chastening, Lord willing, next time. It's 7:15. We've got to go. We've got to clear the building. So let's all stand, because the ceiling falls at, you know, if we go over time. So what I'd like to encourage you is, you ought to write some of these down. You ought to, if you don't have a plan for your devotions this week, you ought to read Hebrews 12. It's one of the most encouraging passages in the Bible. You know what it ends with in verse 24? Those who are registered in heaven. The only people going to heaven have reservations. They're registered. It's wonderful. And you can be ready for next week. And then you'll know how to share. Because these questions that were asked, I've heard for 35 years over and over and over again. These are common ones we all should know the answers to from the Word. Let's bow together for a word of prayer. Father, I thank you. I thank you that the grace of God that brings salvation is so powerful that not only does it enrich us with all the riches in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, and not only does it mean that we are forgiven to the uttermost and that there is no sin that you will not cleanse and utterly forgive us of, but that grace is so powerful that if we really have it, it also gives us the power to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts. And anybody that says they're forgiven also has to say that the grace of God that forgave them is powerful enough to cause us to deny ungodliness. And I pray we'd learn more of that, that we would grow in our understanding of grace. Instead of using it as an excuse, that we would use it as the greatest motivator to holy living, which is what you intended it to be. And we thank you for the precious beginning of this evening, those sweet little voices. And it's out of children that you have perfected praise. So may we have childlike faith as we go into your word this week until you come or call. And if you give us another week to live, I pray that we would come here next Sunday in the Spirit on the Lord's Day and Wednesday night around your table. And may we be those who know your grace. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. God bless you as you go.